America, Nobel Peace Prize winner.
Madam C.J. Walker was a businesswoman who sold hair care products. She became the first African-American millionaire.
Matthew Henson was an African-American explorer. He was the first African-American to reach the geographic North Pole.
John Baptiste Disabled was a Haitian colonist in North America, and he became the father of Chicago.
John Johnson was the first African American man to be on Forbes 400.
Toussaint Louverture was the leader of the Haitian Revolution. It was the first black independent country in the Western Hemisphere.
Adam Leroy Lock was a writer, a philosopher, an educator, and a patron of the arts. He is known for writing on and about the Harlem Renaissance. He is unofficially named the father of the Harlem Renaissance.
Do you know that Alexander Lewis Twilight was the first African-American to earn a bachelor's degree of American college?
Marcus Garvey was a black nationalist from Jamaica. He founded the UNIA.
Mary James Patterson was the first black American woman to graduate from college.
Louis Latimer was an African American inventor. He helped to discover the electric light bulb.
Phyllis Wheatley was the first published African-American poet.
James Meredith was the first African-American student at the University of Mississippi.
Lonnie G. Johnson invented the Super Soaker water gun. This toy had $1 billion in sales since 2007.
Thomas J. Martin invented the fire extinguisher.
Every voice and sing till earth and heaven rings. Ring with the harmonies of liberty.
Let our rejoicing rise high. Good morning.
Good morning.
Let us all bow our heads in prayer. Or please stand first. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for waking us up this morning, Lord. Please let the choir today sing to the glory of your name and let us represent to you. Let us have a good sermon today. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, even lift them up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Please stand and sing with the choir the introit. Before you as humble as we know how, thanking you for life, health, and strength, thanking you for this brand new day that you have given us. Lord, we thank you for all those who have assembled here and the families they represent. Please help us to lean on you and to be strong and secure in all that we do. Help us as we go forth in this service that our minds will be stayed on you, that we can experience all that you have to give us. Lord, thank you for each person who have given their lives to Christ and those who are still pondering. Help us to say a word or two that would help them come to Christ. Lord, we thank you for each and every person here and each house and home that is represented. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Responsive reading would be led by Deacon Kelvin Smith, 579.
Our responsive reading, 579, faith, taken from Hebrews 11th chapter, verse 1 through 10. Leaders will read light print, congregation read a bold print. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. By faith, Enoch was taken away, so that he did not see death and was not found, because God has taken him. For before him he was taken, he had his testimony that he pleased God. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundation, whose builders and maker is God. Amen.
Ushers, you may allow the worshipers to enter. During this time, there will be no moving around.
Every voice.
we will have the Black History Reflections, after which welcome and announcements by Sister Kawana Burnett.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I am Hagar, the dark-skinned Egyptian, handmaiden to Sarah. I bore Abraham's child, Ishmael, referred to as the lad in the Bible. I am Zipporah, the Ethiopian wife of Moses. I am of the Cushite lineage. I am Makeda. The scriptures refer to me as the Queen of Sheba. I am as black as the midnight sky, and yes, Solomon loved me. I am Harriet Tubman, the Black Moses, abolitionist, warrior. I led hundreds of enslaved people to freedom. I was born into slavery in 1820. But I escaped in 1849. I'm a bad woman. I am Mary McLeod Bethune, born in 1875, founder of the National Council of Negro Women. My statue in Washington, D.C. was the first depicting any woman in any part in the nation's capital. I am Mamie Teal. My only son, Emmett, was lied on, kidnapped, tortured, and murdered August 24th, 1955. Broke my soul. Leave that coffin open. I want the world to see what they did to my child. I am Rosa Parks. I will not get up. I am Angela Davis. I won't shut up. I am Shirley Chisholm. I won't give up. I am Michelle Obama. When they go low, we go high. I am Black royalty.
Wade in the water.
Before Harriet Tubman, the Black Moses, there was another African-American icon, one of my sheroes. Around 1797, she was born a slave named Isabella in Ulster County, New York. She was sold from one owner to another until finally residing in New Paltz, New York. She had a religious conversion and was emancipated under New York State Law of 1827. She worked during the week and preached for on the weekends. She became an evangelist who gained the reputation as a gifted Methodist preacher and visionary. God commanded her to take a new name, Sojourner, in recognition of her future sojourn throughout the nation as God's anointed. She took the last name, Truth, for herself. She was determined she would, for the rest of her life, declare truth. Sojourner Truth. Preacher and orator. She spoke about the injustices of slavery and about the rights of human beings and the rights of women, too. In the late 1840s, she began speaking on the abolitionist circuit. In 1850, she attended her first women's rights convention, where she and the late, that is late, President Trump, Frederick Douglass, were on the program. She was a bold and intrepid religious leader, abolitionist, and women's rights activist. Her oration and singing was in direct contrast to the timidity of the white women involved in the women's rights movement. Her most famous speech was in 1851 at the Women's Rights Convention in Akron, Ohio. This convention lasted 2 days. On the first day, the white men present talked about the inferiority of women and persons of African descent. They also questioned whether women had rights since Christ was not a woman. Sojourner Truth said nothing on the first day. She sat on the steps of the pulpit, but on the second day, Sojourner rose. Use your sanctified imagination, all 6 foot of her, and spoke truth to power. Frances Gage, chair of the convention, and others recounted that she said the following. Well, children, where there is so much racket, there must be something out of kilter. I think that twixt the Negroes of the South and the women in the North all talking about rights, the white men will be in the fix pretty soon. But what's all this talking about? That man over there, he says women need to be helped into carriages and lifted over ditches and to have the best place everywhere here. Nobody ever helps me in a carriage or over mud puddles or gives me any place that's best. And ain't I a woman? Look at me. Look at my arm. I have plowed and planted and gathered into barns and no man could head me. And ain't I a woman? I could work as much and eat as much as a man when I could get it and bear the lash as well. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children and seen them most all sold off to slavery. And when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? And then they talk about this thing in the head. What's that? What's it? Thank you, honey. Intellect. What's that got to do with Negro rights and women's rights? If my cup won't hold but a pint and yours holds a quart, wouldn't you be mean not to let me have my little half measure? Then that little man over there, in black, he says women can't have as much rights as men because Christ wasn't a woman. Where'd your Christ come from? God and a woman. Man had nothing to do with it. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together, they ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again. And now they're asking to do it. The men better let them. Obliged to you for hearing me. And now old Sojourner ain't gonna have nothing more to say. Fortunately, Sojourner True did say more. She died in 1875 after living a faith-filled, active life. I would like to thank Dr. Jenna Ray McNeil, a professor of history at UNC Chapel Hill, to help me with this presentation. She also has prepared a one-page handout for the entire church in celebration of our Black history that you can pick up after service in the lobby. Thank you, and have a blessed week.
Give an honor to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Good morning. I am the church announcer. Please direct your attention to the monitors at this time.
This is Patricia Dombey reporting live from Oak City Baptist Church. Before I begin the announcements for today, could I have all the visitors stand so we can see your lovely faces?
Here we are, please. Please remain standing, visitors. You'll get a microphone in just a moment.
Hi, I'm Frank Castleberry, and I'm here today as a guest of Mr. Rudolph Lofton Sr. And Mr. Rudolph is celebrating his 90th birthday this month, and I'm just here to I'm just honored to be here with him to help celebrate that. And Mr. Rudolph's just been a dear friend for me for over 15 years, and I tell people, I said I have my school teachers and I have my life teachers, and Mr. Rudolph's been one of my life teachers and one of my greatest ones. And I'm just thankful to be here with him. I said, Rudolph, there's only one, I only have one regret in knowing you. And he said, well, what's that? He said, I just didn't know you sooner, Rudolph. So thank you for letting me be here.
Good morning. My name is Javon Montfort, and this is my Uncle Rudolph Lofton, and I'm glad to be here with y'all today.
Good morning also. My name is Alice Montfort, and this is my Uncle Rudolph.
I'm the talk of the family. Good morning, church. My name is Shelby Lofton, and I bring you greetings from St. Mark Church in Goldsboro, North Carolina, where my pastor is the General Bishop Alton Avon Smith. And we're here today to help celebrate my uncle's birthday. We love coming to your church, and we don't get away often, but hi, Pastor. We came to visit. Amen.
Church in Cary, North Carolina. And I came because a relative of the pastor's recommended this church. He's from Rocky Point, North Carolina. Have a good day.
Or maybe see. These are the announcements for this week. Please join us for prayer meeting and Bible study Wednesday, February 8th at 6:30 p.m. Praise and worship service will be on Friday, February 17th at 7 p.m. And let's not forget Sunday school. Sunday school is on every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. There are classes for all ages, so let's all come out and fellowship in God's word. Okay, I have a new announcement. The second annual community bowl will be on February 24th at 6 p.m. There will be food, fellowship, fun, artifacts, and storytelling. So we're inviting everyone to come out and join us. That's all the announcements I have for you today. Thank you and have a blessed week.
Thank you, Patricia. In addition to her announcements, the following meetings will be held today after morning worship service. The youth ministry will meet in the boardroom. The missionary ministry needs help with serving at the men's shelter Tuesday, February 21st at 5:30 p.m. The missionary ministry will be visiting with Mrs. Elaine Grisby Sunday, February 19th after morning service. Others are invited to attend. The membership committee will meet today following worship service in the choir room, which is directly behind me. Attention, youth. The financial literacy ministry will hold a financial workshop for the church's youth on Wednesday, February 22nd at 6:30 p.m. All youth are encouraged to attend. Please submit your articles for the Oak City newsletter by Sunday, February 26th. Thank you, the Communications Committee. OCBC Twilighters, Mental Stimulation Day. Join us on March 15th from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Come out and learn, teach, and share skills, games, puzzles, and more that are appropriate to be played at church. All seniors and friends are invited for fun, fellowship, and a light lunch. Bring your own games and invite your friends. Sign up in the administrative office by March 8th, 2017. Oak City Baptist Church Twilighters, James Samuel, Chairperson. Last but not least, let us remember our sick and our shut-ins, not only with calls, cards, and visits, but most important, with our prayers. This concludes the announcements for today, and have a blessed week.
Please allow those who are waiting to come in. Good morning.
Good morning.
We honor the Lord and thank him for this beautiful springtime weather. This beautiful day, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. We honor our presider this morning, Deaconess Veronica Smith, also the chairperson of our Adoption and Foster Care Ministry. Today we are celebrating Adoption and Foster Care along with Black History. We honor all of my former clergy members, praise the Lord, all of my colleagues in ministry, and also other members of the committee, Deaconess Priscilla Batts. And we honor all of our deacons and other leaders, any visiting clergy, we honor you. Beloved church family, we love and honor you. And our visiting friends, we also honor you today. Brother Castleberry, the Montfort family, Sister Lofton, Sister Dunn, was it Dunn from Cary? Munn. Praise God. We're glad to have you here, and we're so happy somebody from Rocky Point recommended that you come. Praise the Lord. I was in Rocky Point yesterday. Praise the Lord. In fact, Wilmington passed through Rocky Point. And we also greet all others who are here. We thank God for your presence this morning, and we greet you in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's good to see you. You look good. God's blessing his people. We are so happy to see the family members of Deacon Lofton come. He is our oldest male in the church. He has been a jewel to Oak City for many, many years. He's the one responsible primarily for my being here because he's the one who brought the recommendation to Oak City that I come and preach while you were without a pastor. And Oak City agreed. And later they voted that they wanted me to come and serve. So I owe a great debt of gratitude to Deacon Lofton, the other deacons who were serving at that time, and this church. It's been almost 29 years, and I thank God. Praise the Lord. Thank God for Deacon Lofton and for the Lord. And by the way, all February birthdays are going to be recognized today with a little punch and cake, I believe, right after service. Deacon Richard Jones has arranged, along with some help, to have a little repast for all February birthdays. So if you were born in February, and whether it's today or the whole month, please go to the fellowship hall right after the benediction. And after the February birthdays, any leftovers can go to anybody else. Praise the Lord. But we want to take care of February first. Amen. It's good to see Sister Agnes Shoulders here. Praise the Lord. Sister Shoulders, it's good to see you. Sister Benita Shoulders' mom and Callion's grandmom. And you see her daughter sitting there with her, Sister Betty. Praise the Lord. We just thank God that you came back today to see and visit with us. Your daughter and rest of the family donated a picture to Oak City in honor of Sister Benita. And that picture's hanging back here in this room. If you get a chance to stop by before leaving, stop by and see that picture. It's a nice oak tree. and it represents her life. It is still living through that oak tree and through the rest of us and the rest of the family. So we thank God for all of you today. This youth choir, what about this youth choir? Don't they look good? Don't they sound good? I was back in the office while they were doing praise and worship, and I heard Destiny lead off, and then, praise the Lord, Mariah started, picked it up, and we just are so proud, so many up there this morning. They look good and they sound good. Thank you. Let's give them another hand. I just got off the phone this morning at 10:30 with Dr. David Olukani. He called me from Nigeria. As you know, he was a member here while he was enrolled in a doctoral program at NC State. He came back for some type of internship, and he came back to us for a short while. He is now teaching at the university, one of the universities in Nigeria. He called just to say hello. I had a chance to speak to his two children, and he might be watching right now because I told him about the live streaming. So just wanted you to know he sends his very best regards. He said continue to pray for him, and he'll do the same for us. As you know, he loves the Lord. And we thank God. I had a chance to talk with him this morning between 10:30 and 10:35. What about the youth announcements this morning? Video announcements of our youth. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Patricia did a great job kicking it off, and Benny gave her a little help to remind her that she missed one. And Michael was on the camera. Michael is now part of the media ministry, operating the camera. From time to time, you will see youth involved in making announcements. So all youth are invited to participate. Now you have to come on Wednesday night. We're asking you primarily to come on Wednesday night for our Bible study. That's the time Trustee Patrick McNair will try to pull some of our youth together to have them to prepare and videotape the announcements for that particular week. We won't do it every week. We want to try to do it at least once a month. And then if we get really good at it, it might be every week. And at some point, it might replace, you know, the verbal announcements that we have every Sunday. But right now, we're trying to get more of our youth involved. And one thing they really like is technology. They really like technology. They are good at it. They can do some things we adults can't do. And I want to thank Trustee Patrick McNair, who is such a great asset to Oak City Baptist Church. He's such a blessing to Oak City. He volunteers his time to come out during the week to prepare for our Sunday services. I have to get him the information about a week in advance or a few days in advance so he can put it on videotape. He trains the other staff. We have all of them who are volunteering. Brother McLean on the sound, he's also trying to train others. When he's not here, they can take over. But Trustee Patrick McNair is the leader. He's the coordinator of our media ministry, and he does it free of charge. That's a blessing to this church to have someone with that gift and talent and to donate their time. In many places, you have to pay a big dollar, a great big dollar, to get people that expertise to be here every Sunday and all during the week to prepare for Sunday or Friday night or whatever we have going on. So thank you. I also want to applaud our Black History Committee under the leadership of former judge and attorney Karen Bethia Shields. She and Sister Kawana Burnett did a wonderful job this morning. They did a wonderful job last week. We got two more Sundays to go. Two more Sundays to go. They'll do something for us next Sunday as well, even though we're having deacon ordination service next Sunday, and please come for that as we ordain two deacons during our 11 o'clock service on next Sunday. And then on the fourth Sunday, that will be the Black History Committee's Day, where they will lead us in worship, and they'll have a little bit more time to share with us another segment of Black history. This is a time for all of us to celebrate our rich heritage. We have a very rich heritage and a very rich history. And if we don't remember it and don't keep on celebrating it, sometimes we tend to forget it. And if you forget it, sometimes you end up repeating some stuff that's not so good. So we don't want to do that. I want to applaud also the men's ministry that met on yesterday. 21 people attended the men's ministry meeting. They have decided to study another book by Dr. Tony Evans. He is the one that they studied earlier. This book, I believe, is called Watch Your Mouth, and it will be presented by several presenters. Reverend Lucas taught the other book all by himself. This time, there'll be different presenters taking a particular chapter certain months, each month. So I applaud Deacon Kevin Smith, Deacon-elect Calvin Davis, and Reverend Lucas as they work together as a leadership team to lead our men's ministry. And by the way, Deacon-elect Davis is out suffering with a cold or some type of ailment today. A lot of people have the flu. First Lady also has the flu, so several people out because of either flu bug or some type of cold, and we will be lifting them up. I have some correspondence from someone that you all may remember, Sister Fanny Montague, and her daughter sent me some correspondence just to let me know that she is still with her in Maryland, actually in Virginia. And I have pictures of Sister Montague. She's suffering with dementia right now, and she has dementia that's not as bad as it could be, but it's worse than it used to be. And she is on this with her grandchildren. One grandchild, the oldest one, is 11 years old. His name is Lewis Couch. And then the girl is Jillian, who is 9 years old. And Sister Deidre sent this, who's the daughter, and her husband is on here as well. If you'd like to see some of these pictures, see me after church or stop by the office and we'll try to have it for you. But she just wanted to let us know that Sister Fanny Montague is still feisty and is still kicking. And even though she's having to deal with this health ailment, she wanted to know she has not forgotten about Oak City Baptist Church. And we certainly haven't forgotten about her. Her husband was a member of the male chorus, as you know, who went to be with the Lord back in 2011. And since that time, Sister Montague has been dealing with dementia. Want to mention that the Men's Day Committee will not meet today after service. I also want to recognize a couple of our youth. First, BJ, Brian Keith Jr., they call him BJ. Please stand. BJ plays ball over at Cary High School. He's probably the only freshman on the team, and he's probably the sixth man. When I went to see him, he was the first substitute the coach put in the game. He's a point guard, quick as a cat. He was also featured in the News and Observer on Tuesday, this past Tuesday. And one of the things that I'm so proud of him is that he plays hard. His team right now is in the running for the championship in their conference. I think they're in second place behind Green Hope. And they have a good chance of going to the playoffs, which will be leading up to the state championship. And Brian, I just want to say we're so proud of you. He can shoot, he can handle the ball, and he's a tenacious defensive player. And we're proud of him making the newspaper on Tuesday. Give Brian, BJ, a big hand. Keep up the good work. And by the way, they won that game that I went to see, even though I had to leave at halftime. And they won this past Friday night. They won this past Tuesday night. So they're on a winning streak. They haven't lost many this year. Zaquan, they call him Z. Will you play, Stan, his brother? When I went to see BJ play, I was surprised to see the person singing the national anthem at the game was his brother, Zaquan. And he did a marvelous job singing it a cappella. Talking about a nice voice, he has a tremendous voice. Give Zaquan a hand. Two brothers doing a great job. We applaud their parents as well. They're doing a fantastic job raising their sons. And by the way, Bryson plays AAU ball. He's the youngest, so he's up and coming star too. Stand up, Bryson, so they can see you. There he is. Praise the Lord. He's up and coming. Won't be long. All right, you may be seated. Praise the Lord. Brianna Jones, please stand. Brianna's up in the choir. Let me tell you, Brianna told me something last summer, at least her mother did, and say, just hold it for a while because we want to wait until some other things are finalized before we announce it. Don't want to announce it too soon. But why don't you know that she's been accepted at Wake Forest University. Wake Forest University. She was accepted last August, but told me to hold it until later. So I got word. You can go ahead and say something now. She is the new Damon Deacon. But by the way, she's an Oak City Angel. All right. Congratulations, Brianna. Congratulations. Everybody can't get in Wake Forest. I want you to know that. We're proud of you, Brianna. We know you'll do a good job. I think that's about it, except I'd like to share on the prayer list, we are praying for the family of Sister Lynn Threet. Deaconess Lynn Threet had an uncle to pass away. This uncle lived in Virginia and was quite ill, and she brought him to Raleigh to stay with her to Nightdale, where they live. She's been taking care of him. He passed away earlier this week. I think it was either Sunday night or Monday. And his service, his memorial service, be held next Saturday. It'll be a memorial service over at Lee Funeral Home at 12 Noon. His name is Herbert Taylor. So lift up Deaconess Lynn Threet, her uncle, I think it's her father's brother, who passed away. And the memorial service will be held on next Saturday at 12 Noon at Lee Funeral Home. The Threets were in Texas, I believe, on yesterday when I talked to them, so I'm not sure if they've gotten back to Raleigh or Nightdale yet. We're also praying for many others on the prayer list. You see the names in the bulletin for those who are members of the church. For the non-members, I won't call the 34 names, but we are praying for Reverend Lucas' mother, who is having some health challenges right now, more severe than in the past, and Sister Nazreen Nasser, one of our members from Pakistan, who now lives in Houston, Texas. She had open heart surgery on last Friday. Everything went well. She went home on Thursday morning and is doing well still. So continue to pray for Sister Nazreen Nasser and her daughter Naratan as she is recovering from open heart surgery that lasted a long, long time on Friday morning. The birthdays again are listed in the bulletin for this week. Happy birthday to Deaconess Emeritus Eulalia Hort, who has a birthday on today. April, my oldest child, has a birthday on tomorrow. On the 15th, our Deacon Emeritus, Deacon Rudolph Lawson Sr., has a birthday. And then on the 16th, our own Reverend Timothy Sean Lucas has a birthday. That's all right. Okay. And if there's anyone else with a birthday this week, we say happy birthday to you. And may God bless you to have many, many more. Okay? All right.
Malachi 3:10 says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. We'll ask Deacon Richard Jones to come do our offertory prayer, after which the ushers would take charge.
Let us stand. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we first thank you for allowing us to assemble here this day. We thank you for all that you have allowed us to obtain. And then, Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to give back a portion of what you so richly given to us. And we know that it's more blessed to receive, to give than to receive. We ask you that you will bless this effort today, Heavenly Father, that we collect, that will be used for the building of your kingdom here on earth. It's in the precious name of Jesus Christ we do pray. Amen.
Priscilla Bass would do our divine reading, after which Deacon Robert Bass would do the morning prayer.
Good morning. Morning. We'll be reading Galatians 3, 26, 4, 1 through 7. Let us read together. For you are all sons of God. through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. Jesus, and it's for your Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from slave, though he is master of all, but is under guardian and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. Even so, we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Amen.
Let us pray. Our Lord, our God, how excellent is thy name. Lord, we give you all praise and honor this morning. Lord, we give you glory. Lord, we honor you for we do anything, Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for being in our lives, for being there, Father, when we need you the most. Lord, I'm asking you right now, Father, to touch the foster and care agencies, Lord, that's all around the world, Father. They're putting forth the hours, they're putting forth the love, they're putting forth the care, Father, to get others into homes where they could be loved and cared for, Lord. Touch that youth, Father, that think they have nowhere to go. Let them know, Lord, that you need, that you're with them, Father, through all things. Heavenly Father, we ask you to touch each and every one, Lord, that when they find a home, that they are comfortable, protected by your love. Lord, we give you glory and honor, Lord. Through all things. Heavenly Father, we ask you to touch this world, Father, as a whole. Touch our leaders, Lord, as they make decisions that affect others. Touch their hearts, Father. Touch their bodies. Touch their minds. Lord, we ask you to lead and guide them through all things. Heavenly Father, we ask you to be at the hospital, to touch that one who might be going through, they're getting bad reports, they're even getting good reports. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. Lord, we ask you to touch that one that needs comforting, that might have lost a loved one. Be with them, Father, through everything that goes on. Lord, we ask you, Lord, to be with our pastor this morning. Touch his mind, Father. Touch his words. Lead and guide him, Father, to give us what you need for us to hear. Lord, be with us at Oak City Baptist Church. Thank you, Lord, for letting us grow and grow together. Thank you for all the blessing, Lord, you have put upon us. Thank you for the challenge, Lord, that you help us to see through. We thank you, Father, for everything that you do. Lord, we just love you, and we give you praise, and we give you honor through all things. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Somebody.
after this special selection, the next voice you will hear will be that of our own Dr. William T. Newkirk, a man of integrity, a father, a grandfather, most of all, a man of God. Yeah. So please help me just welcome him by saying, God bless,
God bless.
Reverend Newkirk.
This morning, we'll be ministering the song Wade in the Water. This song was actually suggested by one of our youth. Wade in the Water is the name of a Negro spiritual first published in New Jubilee Songs as sung by the Fisk Jubilee Singers. 1901 by John Wesley Work II and his brother, Frederick J. Work. It is associated with the songs of the Underground Railroad. Many internet sources and popular books claim that the song, such as Way in the Water, contained explicit instructions to fugitive slaves on how to avoid capture and the route to take to successfully make their way to freedom. An example of this is cited in the book Pathways to Freedom, Maryland and the Underground Railroad. The book explains how Harriet Tubman used the song Way in the Water to tell escaping slaves to get off the trail and into the water to make sure that the dogs employed by slavers lost their trail. But for us today, as sons and daughters, heirs to God, the song relates to both the Old Testament and the New. The verses reflect the Israelites' escape out of Egypt as found in Exodus 14. The chorus refers to healing. See John 5, verse 4. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Whoever stepped in first after the troubling of the water was made whole of whatever disease he had, weighed in the water.
Wait in the water, wait in the water, wait in the water.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Wonderful job. Wonderful job. Thank you, Reverend Stone, for your leadership, and Sister Johnson, Sister McDade, Sister Banks. Thank you, young people. Give the young people a big hand. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah. They had to work hard to get that together. But you know, young people can do whatever they put their mind to do. They can get it done. They can get it done. And we're so proud of our youth here at Oak City Baptist Church. They make us so proud. I want to extend additional condolences to the family of Elder Larry David Kulchenberg, who is now with the Lord. His homegoing celebration was held last Saturday, a week ago almost. And we thank God that today his in-laws are here. Of course, you know Reverend Dr. Mary Smalls and Deacon Clarence Smalls, but his wife is here today. And we want to just say, Sister Teresa, we'll continue to pray for, hold your hand up, just hold your hand up so people might know who you are. This is the oldest child of the Smalls, and her brother, Benny, is sitting there beside her, and then Kim, all of you know Kim and Chris and her children who are in the choir today. We thank God for your presence, and we'll continue to pray for you. God bless you. We welcome those of you who are joining us by way of television as well as live streaming. We pray God's blessings upon you and that you might be blessed by the singing, the praying, or maybe even the word, that you might be blessed in some form or fashion. Please pray for us and we'll do the same for you. Today we are celebrating our adoption and foster care ministry. And today we have a word that deals with adoption. We've read the background scripture coming from the book of Galatians, Paul's letter to the church at Galatia. Two chapters, a part of the third chapter, verses 26 through 29, and then part of the fourth chapter, verses 4, verses 1 through 7. I'd like to read from that fourth chapter, verses 4 and 5 again. And this is the New King James Version. It reads like this: But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that they might receive the adoption as sons. I want to raise a question in this message today, and the question is, does God believe in adoption? Does God believe in adoption? Today we're celebrating Adoption and Foster Care Sunday in recognition of all foster care, adoption care, and kinship caregivers in our congregation and really in all of Wake County and surrounding areas. Oak City has been participating and partnering with the Wake County Human Services for several years now in an effort to improve the lives of children who are waiting to be adopted. You see, we believe in investing in a child's future. That's the theme of today's program, and we believe in that. There's a role for the church and for every Christian as we try to find foster parents who will adopt children that are in need of adoption. On January 24th, this past January 24th, a luncheon was held here at Oak City Baptist Church, sponsored by the Wake County Human Services Department. They held that luncheon to show appreciation to a group of churches that make up what is called the Child Welfare Faith Community Partnership. I'm so pleased that Oak City Baptist Church was one of those churches. several of us were in attendance. Our leader, Deaconess Veronica Smith, and Sister Batts, Deaconess Batts, Deacon Jones, myself. Adoption, and we were given a plaque that I shared with you earlier, a certificate for our participation and support. Adoption, by the way, is defined as the legal action by which a person takes into his family a child that's not his own, with the purpose of treating that child just like his own and giving that child all the privileges of his own natural child. An adopted child is legally entitled to all the rights and privileges of a natural born child. There's a long list of notable people who were adopted as children by new caring parents. And these people went on to make their mark upon society. People like Alexander the Great, people like Aristotle the philosopher, people like Ingrid Bergman, an actress, Richard Burton, an actor, people like Presidents Bill Clinton and Gerald Ford, people like Charles Dickens, the writer, John Lennon, the former Beatle and musician, people like Marilyn Monroe, the actress, Nancy Reagan, First Lady of these United States of America, and so was Eleanor Roosevelt, former First Lady. Mark Twain, a writer, one of the best known writers. Dave Thomas, the founder of Wendy's. A lot of y'all buy their hamburgers and French fries. Among people of color who were adopted as children, people like Nat King Cole. Anybody ever heard of Nat King Cole? If you're old enough, you've heard of him. A famous singer. Halle Berry, an actress. Les Brown, a motivational speaker. George Washington Carver, an inventor, invented so many things, from a lowly peanut. Dante Culpepper, a former quarterback in the National Football League. Eric Dickerson, former pro football running back. Langston Hughes, a poet and writer. Jesse Jackson, civil rights leader. Malcolm X, a civil rights leader. And Nelson Mandela, former political prisoner and former president of South Africa. That's only a sampling of notable people who were adopted by at least one parent, and sometimes two, when they were children. Even though the Bible uses the word adopt only four times, it refers to the concept of adoption many, many times. When the Bible does speak out on adoption, it is presented as something positive and as something special to God. It's also special to God's plan for all of humanity. Moses, for instance, was adopted by Pharaoh's daughter. The story is told in the book of Exodus. And even though Moses' adoption was probably a sad occasion for his parents, it was a part of God's overall plan for the deliverance of the Israelites out of Egypt bondage. Esther was adopted. Her story is told in the book of Esther in the Old Testament. When her parents died, her cousin Mordecai took her as his only adopted daughter. Esther's adoption led once again to a tremendous deliverance of the Israelites, the adopted and chosen people of Almighty God. Samuel was adopted. adopted by the prophet Eli. Even though Samuel's mother maintained contact with him and visited him at least once a year, Eli was his primary caretaker. In a way, Jesus was adopted. Joseph raised Jesus as his own, even though he was not his biological father. I believe adopting parents can learn a whole lot by looking at the life of Joseph, the father, adopted father, stepfather, whatever you want to call him, of Jesus. Joseph, as a surrogate father, was truly unselfish. He was willing to rearrange his entire life in obedience to God's instructions. He gladly accepted Jesus as his own son, providing him with the love, the encouragement, and the guidance that any son needs from a father. And let me tell you, church, you can just look at society today. Look at the prisons today. Look at the streets today. Look at what some young boys are doing. When the father is not there to provide guidance, many of our young people go astray, particularly the young males. When you see a young man walking around with his pants hanging down, it's because there's been nobody there to tell him that's not appropriate. It does nothing to your self-esteem. It does nothing to your legacy. It does nothing to your position in life. It does nothing to your future. It does nothing to your prospects to walk around with your pants hanging down, showing your underwear as if it's something they're proud to be proud of. Somebody's got to teach them. And when you've got a man there in the home, at least if he's got his head on straight, he'll tell him it's not the thing to do. There's another adoption story, however, that is perhaps the most important of them all. And that's the biological story of how all of us must enter into the kingdom of God. All of us must become adopted sons and daughters of God through his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I mean, all of us must do it. If we're to have any hope for eternal life, we must become adopted sons and adopted daughters. The Apostle Paul talks about that. He talks about how it happens in the opening statement in the book of Ephesians. It's there in Ephesians chapter 1 in verses 3 through 6, where we are redeemed and adopted in Christ and through Christ. It reads like this: Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption. Everybody say adoption. To adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself. And by the way, that could be sons and daughters, by the way, now. That's not just males. He's talking about all of his creation, all his children. According to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. He made us accepted in the beloved. There it is. There it is. We are blessed with every spiritual blessing in Jesus Christ. We are chosen. We are chosen. We are made holy. Not because of you. Because of God. We are made holy. We are made blameless because of God's love for us. And most of all, we are adopted as sons and daughters by God Himself through His Son, Jesus the Christ. Praise the Lord. This is all done through God's good pleasure and so that He might be praised. Do you think God deserves some praise? Do you think He deserves some praise for adopting us as sons and daughters? God chose us to be His adopted children, not because He had to. He does it because He wants to. In adopting us, He shows the depth of His love for all of us, for each of us. What a marvelous example that is for every parent today who's willing to adopt a child. It's all about love. In her book entitled In Mommy's Heart, Dr. Jan Galton writes of how a first grade teacher was discussing the picture of a family that one of her students brought to school. One of the children in the picture looked different from the others. The hair was different, as well as the child's appearance. A little girl in the class said, "Maybe the child looked different because the child had been adopted." The little girl went on to say, "I know all about adoptions because I was adopted." Another student in the class asked the little girl, "What does it mean to be adopted?" The little girl said, "It means that you grew up in your mommy's heart rather than in her tummy." And church, that is really what love is all about. That is also what the grace of God is all about. It's about love. Spiritually speaking, our adoption as children of the living God first began in the heart of God. It is God's love and God's grace that all of us enjoy today. None of us deserve it, but it's ours. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. There are a few serious issues, though, surrounding adopted children, just as there are some issues surrounding all children. But according to the Psychology of Adoption, printed by the Oxford University Press, 1993, it said adopted children have a few major issues to overcome. Statistics show that that adopted children face some very special challenges. Some of them deal with concerns over being abandoned. Some face what may account to as a crisis over their identity. Some have issues with intimacy because they've been rejected. That is, they may experience some difficulty accepting love as well as giving love. The trust factor is also something that enters the picture. Adopted children, when they are older, have learned to protect themselves from being hurt over and over and over again. They tend to have higher rates of delinquent behavior, learning disorders, and attention deficit disorder. Adopted children, like all children, may need to seek out therapy. But the rate for adopted children is above average. Their challenges are somewhat greater than those who are blessed to remain in homes with their natural biological parents, especially when they are adopted late in life. But there's some good news. Everybody say good news. The good news is, All of the above can be overcome. Whatever physical, whatever emotional, whatever mental, or whatever spiritual disorder anyone may have, these things can be corrected. They can be overcome. A good starting point is with our background scripture we have before us today. Let us revisit our scripture again to see what God is saying to us about spiritual adoption. It doesn't matter what happened in your past. Maybe you've had a rough past. There's nothing you can do to change your past now. But you can do something about your future. You can do something about your life today. First, you need to realize who you are. Then you need to realize whose you are. You have been adopted into the family of God. Your job is just to believe it and also accept it. Again, Galatians, the 3rd chapter, verses 26 and 27 say, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ." There it is. Does God believe in adoption? You bet he does. The most important decision you ever make, church, is deciding to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Once that decision is made, you are adopted into the family of God. You then have a father to love you. And I mean God will love you like nobody else can love you. You are then a son or a daughter of God. You are then given full rights as a son and full rights as a daughter. Someone may want to know, well, what are those rights? Well, let me tell you. There are 6 specific rights you have according to Scripture. Having been adopted by God allows you to have these rights. Number 1. You have the right to enjoy a new father. Yes, you have the right to enjoy a new father. He's a father unlike any father you will ever know. He's a father who will love you unconditionally. I mean, everybody won't love you unconditionally. They'll put certain conditions on their love. I mean, if you act right, I'm going to love you. If you do right, I'm going to love you. If you treat me right, I'm going to love you. But if you don't come up to your part of the deal, there ain't no love coming from me. But the God the Father will love you unconditionally. He's a father who will never be an absentee father. He's a father that will be there when you need him. He's a father who will always be right there. You have the right to enjoy a new father. That's the first point. Number two, you have a right to enjoy a new spirit and a new attitude. Because you are sons and daughters or daughters, God has given you a new spirit and a whole brand new attitude. It's the same spirit of Christ that he has placed in our hearts. You no longer have to be sad or grumpy. You no longer have to be depressed. You no longer have to be miserable. You no longer have to be discouraged. There is no need for you to give people a hard time. You don't have to be bossy. You don't have to be all of that because you've got a new dad. You've got a new family. You've got a new hope. And you've got a whole new life. Number 3, you have the right to enjoy a new relationship of intimacy. Yeah, you got a right to enjoy a new relationship of intimacy. With your new spirit, you and I now have the right to call out, Abba, Father. Abba is a term meaning daddy. It's an intimate term that only a son or a daughter can use. Everybody can't use the term daddy. Slaves and strangers are not allowed to use that term. Only a son or a daughter has that right. Whenever you surrendered everything to Christ, you were given the right to call God Abba Father. He's your daddy. And daddy's a less formal. Daddy's a more fun. And daddy's a perhaps more loving and a little closer than a father might be. So you have the right to enjoy a new relationship of intimacy through Abba Father. Number four, you have the right to approach the Father at any time. He's always available. You can talk to him at any time. You can call on him 24/7. I mean, he won't close the door and say, "Don't bother me." He won't get his hat and hit the road, and you may not see him until tomorrow. When you are a son or a daughter, you can approach the Father at midnight. You can approach the Father at 3 o'clock in the morning. You can approach the Father at any time, and he'll never turn you away. You have the right to approach the Father at any time. Number five, you have the right to enjoy a new position. I mean, you are no longer a slave. Satan may want you to believe you're still a slave. He may want you to believe you're still in bondage. He may want you to believe that you're still his, but Satan is a liar. You now have a brand new position. You are now a son of the living God. You are now a daughter of the living God. And you've got certain unalienable rights that cannot be taken away. Number six, you have the right to enjoy your inheritance. Yeah, you've inherited something. Your inheritance as a son or a daughter makes you an heir of whatever the King of Kings owns. We are joint heirs with Jesus Christ, our Lord. We inherit whatever God owns. Isn't that good news? It's good to know. It's good to know, church, that we can have it all. I mean, we can have it all. We are heirs of the King. All of God's kingdom belongs to us. Let me close with this adoption story. On one occasion, an orphan boy was living with his grandmother when their house caught on fire. The grandmother, who lived downstairs, perished from smoke inhalation while trying to reach her grandson, who was upstairs. The boy's cries for help were heard and eventually answered by a man who climbed an iron drain pipe to reach the boy. The man shimmied back down the drain pipe with the young boy hanging on around his neck, hanging on as tightly as he could. Several weeks later, a public hearing was held to determine who would get custody of the young boy. There were no other relatives in the family. A businessman, a teacher, and one of the town's wealthiest citizens all petitioned the court to raise the young boy. Each of them gave excellent reasons why they should be chosen to give the boy a new home, which would be a good home. As the proceedings went on, the young boy kept his eyes focused on the floor, wouldn't even look up. He didn't seem excited at all about what was going on in that court proceeding. Then a stranger walked into the courtroom, made his way up front, and addressed the courtroom. He removed his hands from his pockets and it revealed severe burn scars all over his hands and arms. As the crowd gasped at what they saw, the young boy cried out when he saw the man and said, "That's the man who saved my life." The man's hands had been burned when he climbed a hot drain pipe to rescue the boy from the burning house. The young boy leaped up and ran into the man's open arms and held on tightly. And the other people who had offered to give the boy a home slowly left the courtroom. The man with the marred hands had settled the issue. The boy would be his. Church, I want you to know, we have a Savior. We have a Savior who has two marred hands. His nail-scarred hands should always remind us that he has saved us and rescued us from a greater fire than you ever know in your life. This is the Savior who has saved us from eternal fire. He rescued us from a fire, from all the heartache of sin. He has rescued us. Church, our Savior has rescued us from a darkness that we've been walking through all of our lives. He has rescued us. We have a Savior who's paid the ultimate price. He has paid it all for each one of us. His scars are on his hands now, where he gave his all for each one of us. He paid the ultimate sacrifice that we might be adopted sons and adopted daughters. All of us have that right. The Bible tells us when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons and daughters of Almighty God. We've been bought and paid for with the price. Don't you know that God believes in adoption? Yes, he does. Yes, he does. Because all of us have been adopted. And everybody said amen, amen, and amen. Be someone here today, who has not been adopted yet. I'm talking about spiritually adopted. Someone today who has not surrendered everything to the Lord, and you're still out there on your own. I want you to know he has paid a tremendous price so that you can be adopted. If you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to invite you to come today. Come and receive him. Don't let his sacrifice go for nothing. He died for you. He died for you. Don't let it go for nothing. If you're looking for a church home and Oak City feels like a good fit for you, come. Let us talk with you about membership. Stand with me, please. Stand with me as the choir sings our invitational selection.
I wanted to mention the fact Reverend Newkirk mentioned the January luncheon. During that January luncheon, Nika Lyons, the consultant for Wake County Human Services, talked about how the churches came together over 2016 and exceeded all her expectations. And she mentioned several things that, several items that were given during the year that she never knew would be that abundant. And one thing she mentioned was the luggage drive. And I know that we at Oak City came through over the year, over the year 2016. I stopped counting, but I know I got at least 50 pieces of luggage, and I know I got more than that. And it came from you. So we did our part. I don't know what the other churches did, but we did our part. And she mentioned the supplies drive and how there was an abundance of supplies given. And I know that I got supplies just 2 weeks ago. Somebody brought me more supplies 2 weeks ago. So we're still getting things. It don't have to be a certain time of year. We're just appreciative any time of year that you give these items. And she mentioned other things too. But I just wanted to thank Reverend Newkirk and to thank you, because we're just the representatives. You're the ones who we come to ask for luggage, and we ask you for luggage and supplies and for t-shirts and socks and all these other things. We ask you for, and you come through. So for those of you who don't know anything about this program and want to give, you know, talk to one of us anytime you get ready about this program. But we are always in the giving business, and we'll take these items any time of the year. So I thank you, because you're the one that made it happen.
Thank you, Sister Smith. Join me in giving Sister Smith and other members of the Adoption and Foster Care Ministry a big hand. I want to ask them to stand at this time. All members of the committee, please stand. All members, please stand. Adoption and Foster Care Ministry. I know Deaconess Batts had to leave out. All right. Let's give them a hand now. Thank you for being here today. Thank you. I apologize. Sometimes I get emotional.
I don't apologize. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Sometimes, when you think about the goodness of the Lord and what He's done for you, sometimes you just overcome with emotion. When you know what God has done in your life. Let us all stand. Thank you again. We're going to say the blessing over the repast. We're going to say the prayer for those who are sick and shut in, and then the benediction. So if you will, bow your heads with me. Lord, we thank and praise you for allowing us to have another worship experience. We thank you for our adoption and foster care ministry and the great job they do. We thank you for the leadership that's provided through Deaconess Smith and all of those who labor alongside of her. Thank you for our church family who always answers and responds to the call when there's a need to help others who are less fortunate than we are. We ask your blessing upon the audience that's been a part of this service and others, O God, as we celebrate Black History Month. We pray that you might help us to remember our rich heritage. Bless those who came to be a part of this service today, those who are present. We ask your blessings upon those who are on the prayer list, those in bereavement. We ask that you might raise up those on their sick beds. Help them to know there's a God who still saves. There's a God who still heals. There's a God who still delivers. And now, Lord, we ask your blessings upon the repast, all the February birthdays, and all of their loved ones. We ask that you might bless the hands prepared to repast and help us to be a blessing to others. And we'll give you all the praise, honor, and glory. Now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus, the fellowship and communion of God's Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Let us all sing together.
Amen. Amen.
bless you.